Good morning. My name is Jim Birchfield, senior pastor here at First Presbyterian Church, Houston, and it's my great pleasure to be the first to welcome you to our worship service today. Before we begin our broadcast, I'd like to share a few things that we hope will improve your worship experience. First, we would love to know that you are here and if there are any ways that we can serve you. During today's service, our online pastor will join you in worship and be available to respond to any messages or questions that you might want to share online. If you're joining us on Facebook, please take a moment to like the service or to say hello. If you feel there is someone who might benefit from today's message, we encourage you to share it. If you're joining us from our website, you can complete a connection card, view today's bulletin, or share a need via our live prayer button. Finally, if you're a member of the FPC community or just want to contribute to the ongoing ministry initiatives of our church, you can give online or via text by clicking our Give Online button. Friends, I understand that this is a time when we may still seem far apart from one another. Please know that in this season, you are not alone. We are reminded that Christ is with us, that Christ is for us, and that Christ loves us. Remember that He promises us His peace, a peace we can own, and a peace that transcends all understanding. Your FPC family is with you and remains here to serve you. Please enjoy our service.
And welcome to worship. Pastor Emmanuel and I are so looking forward to getting to worship with you this morning. It's especially important in difficult times of year or difficult years like this one to continue to have the practice of gathering in worship. And so we are glad that you are here today, wherever here is for you. We are praying that today in worship, you would encounter the living God, the God of hope, the God of power, and the God of promise. As we continue in worship, Pastor Emmanuel will open us in prayer.
Let us pray. Father, thank you for giving us the opportunity to worship you in this last Sunday of this year. This has been a hard year, Father. Wherever we are worshiping, whether we are in our living rooms or our bedrooms or our backyards, help us, Father, to bring all of our worries and frustrations and losses to the feet of your cross so that we can place all of our anxieties there so that we can pay attention to what you have to tell us today. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us worship together.
Sing, and heaven and nature sing.
Amen. One of the reasons that we can have so much joy at Christ's coming is because he rules the world with truth and grace. Every week, we come in a prayer of confession that allows us to experience his truth and his grace in our lives. This is a little microcosm of the gospel. So will you join me in this prayer of confession as we experience his forgiveness today? Everlasting God, you brought the nations to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising. We ask that you would shine your light into our hearts even now, knowing that you are glad to do this, glad to be close to us as we draw near to you. As we think back over the last week, we ask that your Holy Spirit would bring to mind the moments for which we need to ask your forgiveness. Highlight this to us, Lord God, as we listen to these prompts for confession. Did I disobey you in anything? Have I insisted upon doing something about which my conscience was uneasy? Did I pass on to another what was told me in confidence? Am I a slave to appearance, friends, work, or habits? Have I given into an addictive behavior this week? Have I been jealous, impure, critical, irritable, touchy, or distrustful? Have I been prideful? Is there anyone whom I dislike, criticize, hold resentment or anger toward? Have I been honoring, understanding, and generous in my important relationships this week? Did I pursue Christ above all, or have I served idols by making them a priority in my life? Did I make time for the Bible to live in me this week? Did I give God space to speak to me every day? Oh, mighty and merciful Lord, help us lift up our hearts to you and to humbly ask for your forgiveness in the areas you have highlighted to us. God of grace, you have given us Jesus, the light of the world, but so often we choose darkness and cling to things that hide the brightness of your love. Immersed in ourselves, we have not risen to the new life you have given us. Immerse us instead in your Spirit, that forgiven and renewed, we may share your love with our neighbors and the nations, telling of your glory shining in Jesus Christ, our Lord and our light forever. Amen. Friends, 1 John 1:7 gives us the good news of God today. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Hear the good news and receive it deep in your souls. You are embraced by God, you are forgiven by God, and you are strengthened by God to live a renewed life in him. And so it's with great joy that I say, the peace of Christ be with you. And if you have a moment today, go ahead and think about who you can bless with the peace of Christ. We're given the peace of Christ so that we might extend it to others as well. And so just text someone, write them, call them, let them know that you're thinking of them, that you're grateful for them, and maybe share with them something that you learned in today's service. And now we're going to continue in worship with this song of preparation so that we might receive the word of God today.
Here's my heart, Lord.
How do we find joy in a world that feels upside down? Today, we are in the last Sunday of the year 2020. And 2020 has been an odd year, to say the least. It has been a hard year. We all have gone through many disappointments, many forms of suffering, almost a sense of hopelessness. In fact, the CDC, the Center for Disease Control, did a survey in the month of September. They did this among people that were between 18 and 24. And what they found is, within this age group, people between 18 and 24, just in the month of September, 25% of them said they seriously considered suicide. That's how 2020 has been. So the question comes, how do we find enduring joy in a time when the world feels upside down? If you were to go and ask this to a self-help guru or a life coach, they would tell you, wake up in the morning and write three things you're grateful about. That's how you will find joy. And that works, right? God has given all of us common grace. So by developing an attitude of gratitude, we can engender a sense of joy. But you see, the kind of joy that Bible talks about is not this engendered emotion that just comes by something we do, but a deep virtue, a fruit of the Spirit. That kind of joy, which is a deep virtue, not just an evanescent emotion coming from a place where it is the fruit of the Spirit, is what we see in the passage today that we're going to read from Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 to 19. So pay attention as I read Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 to 19. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He will make my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you would keep your Bibles open with you, because we are going to be jumping around in Habakkuk a little bit. So what we see in this passage is, it's not three things that Habakkuk is grateful for. It's six things that he needs that don't work. No fig, no grapes, no olives, no cattle, no sheep, no food. Yet, he says, I will rejoice in the Lord. You see, this is not just power of positive thinking or some kind of a self-help technique. This kind of joy comes from deep spiritual formation. So the question is, how does Habakkuk get to this place of deep spiritual formation that he's able to say, no matter what happens, my joy is in the Lord? We have to kind of go back and see where Habakkuk starts. Habakkuk ends the book with joy, but he starts the book with lament. A lament is a prayer of grief, a prayer of frustration that is uttered before God. A lament is something in which we are honest about our pain, about our doubts, about our losses to God. You see, God wants us to be honest with Him about our pain, our suffering, our frustrations, and our doubts. Let me read the lament part of Habakkuk in chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. So you'll get a glimpse of how this lament from Habakkuk looks like. Habakkuk 1, verse 2. How long, Lord, must I call for help? But you do not listen, or cry out to you violence, but you do not save. Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? You see, this is Habakkuk's pathos and pain that he's pouring out to God in prayer. You see, what's happening now is the Israel is the southern kingdom, which is the tribe of Judah, right? And Babylon is becoming powerful in the east. And it is very clear that Babylon, which is the superpower of that time, is going to come over and sweep over Israel and conquer Israel. The writing is on the wall. So Habakkuk knows that he is going to go from being a free man in Israel to becoming an exile in Babylon. And Babylon is an evil nation. It is a violent nation. So Habakkuk is saying, God, why are you letting this happen? Why is it that I'm going from being a free man to an exile in an evil and violent nation, and you would do nothing about it? Great questions, right? And in the Bible, God allows for this to be there because God wants us to have an expressive faith. God does not want us to repress our feelings of anger or pain or doubt. God wants us to express them to him as a child would to a father. While I was in seminary, I was training as a spiritual director. And one of the key parts of the training is if someone would come up and bring up something that frustrates them, something that disappoints them, then the first question to ask is, have you taken your frustration, have you taken your disappointment, your pain to God in prayer? Oftentimes, when I ask that question to somebody that is the directee, what I would get is a bemused expression in their face, wondering, huh, why did they not do that? Right? Sometimes we have a way of thinking our prayer has to be about praise and all the good things and things that we want. But a key part of prayer is also lament. And that's what we find in the book of Psalms. When we think about the book of Psalms, we think about praise, thanksgiving, worship. They're all different genres in the book of the Psalms. But the majority of the Psalms, falling within these different genres, the majority of the Psalms are actually in the category of lament. You see, David was very good at taking his frustration, his disappointments, his pain to God in prayer. He would pour out his pathos to God in prayer. That is why God called him a man after my own heart. You see, the world that we live in, our temptation is to take our frustrations and vent it to our family and our friends. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes it may lead to gossip, which can be bad, but normally it's okay. But if we just stop there, if we don't take our pain and our frustrations and pour it out to God in prayer, like David, like Habakkuk, then we are missing a key part of the spiritual formation that God wants us to go to. You see, some of us may have some fears. We may think, what if I go and say this lament before God and I get stuck in this place of sadness? Or I get stuck in that place of anger? Or I get stuck in that place of doubt? You know, we have that fear, so we don't want to kind of venture over there. You see, here's the good news. The point of any lament is ultimately to move us to hope, to move us to joy. That's what happens every time in the Psalms. How does that happen in Habakkuk? In Habakkuk, the pathway from lament to joy happens when Habakkuk goes to the second step, which is to listen to God. See, the first step in developing this joy in this upside-down world is being honest about our pain, pouring out our pain to God. And the second step is listening to what God has to
say. And that's what happens in Habakkuk chapter 2. And what does God have to say in Habakkuk chapter 2? God doesn't give Habakkuk some simple platitudes of count your blessings, do this or do that. It's not some simple self-help technique. God tells Habakkuk something very interesting. God tells Habakkuk, yes, you're actually going to go into exile. But here's the thing. I'm going to write a new story there. In Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, he says, but the righteous person will live by his faith. There are some translations that would say faithfulness. The righteous shall live by faith. What is another place where this is quoted? Paul quotes this in Romans 1 and also in Galatians 3. The righteous shall live by faith. You see, what God is saying here is, God is ultimately pointing Habakkuk to the fact that he is using all of this to write a new story, a new covenant of people experiencing God's love through Jesus Christ. And Israel being taken to Babylon is a part of that story. You see, when Israel goes to Babylon, at Babylon, they are dispersed all over the world and they develop the synagogues. Before going to Babylon, Israel did not have the idea of synagogues because all worship was supposed to happen in the Temple of Jerusalem, right? Once the Temple of Jerusalem is destroyed, where do they go and worship while they're in this diaspora spread out all over the Babylonian kingdom? They develop synagogues. And why is this important? Because when the new covenant comes, when Jesus comes and the gospel is fully revealed through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, Paul and other apostles, when they take the gospel out to the Gentile world, what network do they use? They use the network of the synagogues to spread the gospel of the love of Jesus Christ all over the world at that time, right? So that's the ultimate new story that God is writing in this space. In fact, in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 14 says, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. You see, what God is doing is, he is taking the story that Habakkuk has in his mind. In Habakkuk's mind, his story is, I'm a free man, I'm going into an exile. But God is re-narrating that story. God is saying, no, that's not the only story that's going on here. There is a bigger story here. The bigger story that through everything that's happening here, God is going to bring salvation to the whole of the world. God is going to bring the message of the love of Jesus to the whole of the world. That's an important part. Because Habakkuk is so preoccupied with his own small little story, and God is helping him to transcend out of his small little story and petty worries and the preoccupations that come from that into this grand narrative of God's story of redeeming the whole world. That's what happens when Habakkuk listens to God. You know, sometimes when I go through, where I'm frustrated with something small or whatever it is, sometimes it's helpful to go, for me, to listen to Bach's fugues. Why? Because Bach's fugues are magnificent. They're wonderful writings of music that Bach used to glorify God. So when I do that, it takes me away from the preoccupations of my little story and helps me to transcend to the glorious and beautiful world that God has created. So when God does this re-narration for Habakkuk, helping him to understand that he's a part of God's big story, what happens next? Habakkuk breaks into a song. If you read the beginning of chapter 3, your Bible would have two words that says, on Siginoth. They may be italicized at the top. Basically, that Siginoth is the instruction to the one that is playing music to say, play this type of a rhythm. And commentators say, Siginoth is a kind of a, it's a fast rhythm. It's kind of like a triumphant music, right? So when God re-narrates Habakkuk's story so that he can transcend away from his preoccupations of a small story into God's story of salvation, Habakkuk breaks into a song. And chapter 3, verse 1, he says, Lord, I have heard your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, Lord. He moves to a place of worship of God, who is the ultimate sovereign over all of history, working out all of these plans to express his love to the world. And then he says, I repeat them in our day, in our time, make them known. He says he will keep repeating God's glory and the story that God has told him. Why? Because he is trying to find his identity in God's story, in the story that God has given him, instead of trying to find his identity in his own story of whether he's going to be a free man or an exile. You see, when he finds his identity in the story that God is telling him, that is when he moves to this form of enduring joy that can punch through any trials that come to us in an upside-down world. You see, what's happening here is not just some self-help technique. What's happening here is deep spiritual formation, where God is helping Habakkuk to change his identity, to find himself in God's story instead of being kind of frustrated with what's happening in his own story. See, 2020 is an upside-down world. The question before us is, what is God calling us to? We started the year 2020 with many hopes, many dreams, many expectations for joy. The hopes were crushed, the dreams were dashed, the joy is kind of maybe fizzled out. What is God's invitation to us through Habakkuk? He says, be honest about your pain. Pour your pain out to God in prayer. To listen to God. Listen to the new story that God is writing. To the new narrative that God is calling us to. Sometimes we are tempted to listen to the world. But listen to God's voice. And then find our identity in this new story that God has put us in. Knowing well that God is sovereign over all of history and we are God's people. Christian Wiman is a poet at Yale. He says, the plant of joy grows from the soil of sorrow. The plant of joy grows from the soil of sorrow. Christian Wiman was an atheist. He was an atheist poet. And then, at some point in his life, he got cancer. And as he was trying to make sense of life as he was going through cancer, when he thought he was going to die, when he thought all of the hopes and dreams that he had for a long poetic career was going to come to an end. In that place, in that sorrow, in that suffering is where he met God. And he went from being an atheist to being a Christian. He had a change of identity in that place. That's why he says, the plant of joy grows from the sorrow, from the soil of sorrow. That's the invitation that Habakkuk is giving us. Even as we end this year, that's the invitation that God is giving us. Would we pour out our pain to God in prayer? Lament before God? Would we listen to what God has to tell us? pay attention to the new story that he's writing? Would we find our identity in that story of God redeeming the whole world, the one that is sovereign over all of history, helping people to understand the love of God? In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
It's fitting to respond to such a powerful and timely message from Pastor Emmanuel with prayer. So would you join me now in praying? Mighty and merciful God, we know that you hear us, that you love us, that you invite us into intimacy with you by pouring out our hearts to you. And so I pray that you would help us as individuals and as a church body collectively to pour out our pain to you. And there is so much pain around us, God, in our own lives, in our families, in our communities, in our country, around the world. And so we ask that we would not suppress that pain, God, but that we would express it to you, knowing that you call us to cast our anxieties upon you because you care for us. We ask that you would open our ears to hear from you, God, to listen to you, to your new story, your transcendent story of salvation. And we ask that you would help us to hear your voice so clearly, speaking our identity to us, your word to us about who we really are in you, beloved, chosen, accepted, valued. And so we ask, God, that we would take this message to heart today, and that we would live out what we have learned from the sermon. And so we end by praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Perfect Son of Man, in his lips. stead of ruined sinners hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption. See the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory. Grace unmeasured, love untold.
So glad that you could join us online today and be part of our online family here at First Pres. In a few moments, you'll see some announcements scroll across your screen. Stay tuned so you can see what's going on in the life of our church and stay engaged. We want you to continue to be a part of what we're doing here at First Pres. And now I'll ask Pastor Emmanuel to close us with a benediction.
You are the beloved of God, and God is inviting us, no matter what has happened in 2020, to a place of deep joy in Him. And even as you go out here to love and serve the people, may you have the deep joy of the Lord dwell within you. Amen.
you.